This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, In the Court of King Arthur. Author, Samuel Lowe. Chapter 1, Allan Finds a Champion. I cannot carry your message, Sir Knight. Quiet spoken was the lad, though his heart held a moment's fear as scowling and menacing, the knight who sat so easily the large horse flamed fury at his refusal. And why can you not? It is no idle playboy to flaunt Sir Pellymore. Brave knights have found the truth of this at bitter cost. Nevertheless, Sir Knight, you must needs find another message-bearer. I am page to Sir Percival, and he would deem it no service to him, should I bear a strange knight's message. Then by my faith you shall learn your lesson. Since you are but a youth, it would prove but poor sport to thrust my sword through your worthless body. Yet shall I find Sir Percival, and make him pay for the boorishness of his page. In the meantime, take you this. With a sweep, the speaker brought the flat side of his sword down. But if perchance he thought that the boy would await the blow, he found surprise, for that worthy skillfully evaded the weapon's downward thrust. Now then was Sir Pellymore doubly wroth. Odd zounds, and you need a trouncing. And so shall I give it you, else my dignity would not hold its place. Suiting action to word, the knight reared his horse, prepared to bring the boy to earth. It might have gone ill with Allan, but for the appearance at the turn of the road of another figure, also on horseback. The new knight, perceiving trouble, rode forward. "What do we see here?" he questioned. "Sir Knight, whose name I do not know, it seems to me that you are in poor business to quarrel with so youthful a foe. What say you?" "As to with whom I quarrel, is no concern of anyone but myself. I can, however, to suit the purpose, change my foe. Such trouncing as I wish to give this lad I can easily give to you, Sir Knight. And you wish it? You can do no more than try. It may not be so easy as your boasting would seeming indicate. Lad," and the newcomer turned to the boy, "why does this arrogant knight wish you harm?" "He would have me carry a message, a challenge to Sir Kay, and that I cannot do, for even now I bear a message from Sir Percival, whose page I am but yesterday become. And I must hold true to my own lord and liege." "True words and well spoken. And so for you, Sir Knight of the arrogant tongue, I hope your weapon speaks equally well. Prepare you, sir." Sir Pellymore laughed loudly and disdainfully. "I call this great fortune which brings me battle with you, sir, who are unknown but who I hope nonetheless are a true and brave knight." The next second, the two horses crashed together. Sir Pellymore soon proved his skill. The unknown, equally at ease, contented himself with meeting onslaught after onslaught, parrying clever thrusts and wicked blows. So they battled, for many an hour. Allan the boy, with eyes glistening, waited to see the outcome of the brave fight. The unknown, his champion, perhaps would need his aid through some dire misfortune, and he was prepared. Now the unknown changed his method from one of defense to one of offense. But Sir Pellymore was none the less skillful. The third charge of his foe he met so skillfully that both horses crashed to the ground. On foot the two men then fought, well and long. Until, through inadvertence, the unknown's foot slipped and the next moment found his shield splintered and sword broken. "Now then, by my guardian saint, you are truly vanquished," Sir Pellymore exclaimed exultantly. "Say you so?" But the unknown had already hurled himself, weaponless, upon the seeming victor, and seizing him about the waist with mighty strength, hurled him to the ground. And even as the fallen knight, much shaken, prepared to arise, lo, Merlin the wizard appeared and cast him into a deep sleep. "Sire," the wizard declared, "do you indeed run many dangers that thy station should not warrant? And yet I know not whether we, your loyal subjects, would have it otherwise." Now Allan, the boy, realized he was in the presence of the great king. He threw himself upon his knees. "Rise, lad," said King Arthur kindly. "Sir Percival is indeed fortunate to have a page, who while so young, yet is so loyal. So shall we see you again. Kind Merlin," and the king turned to the wizard, "awaken you this sleeping knight whose only sin seems an undue amount of surliness and arrogance, which his bravery and strength more than offset. Now Sir Pellymore rubbed his eyes. "Where am I?" he muttered drowsily. Then as realization came, he sprang to his feet. "Know you then, Sir Pellymore," said Merlin, "he with whom you fought is none other than Arthur the King." The knight stood motionless, dumbfounded. But only for a moment. "If so, then am I prepared for such punishment as may come. But be it what it may, I can say this, that none with whom I fought has had more skill or has shown greater bravery and chivalry. And more than that none can say." And the knight bowed low his head, humbly and yet with a touch of pride. "Thou art a brave knight, Sir Pellymore. And to us it seems, that aside from a hasty temper, thou couldst well honor us by joining the knights of the Round Table. What saith thou?" "That shall I gladly do. And here and now I pledge my loyalty to none other than Arthur, King of Britain, and to my fellow knights. And as for you, boy, I say it now, that my harsh tongue and temper ill became the true knight I claim to be." "Brave words, Sir Pellymore," said the king. "So let us back to the castle. We see that Merlin is already ill at ease." Chapter 2. Allan goes forth. So then the four, the good king, Sir Pellymore, Merlin the wizard, and Allan, page to Sir Percival, came to the great castle of Britain's king. Arthur led them into the great hall, in which were placed many small tables, and in the center of them all was one of exceeding size and round. Here was to be found a place for Sir Pellymore, but though the king searched long, few seats did he find which were not bespoken. Yet finally he found one which did well for the new arrival. "Here then shall you find your place at the Round Table, good knight," said the king. "And we trust that you will bring renown and honor to your fellowship, succor to those who are in need, and that always will you show true chivalry. And we doubt not but you will do all of these." Sir Pellymore bowed low his head, nor did he make reply, because within him surged a great feeling of gratitude. The king turned away, and Merlin followed him to the upraised dais. So now the two seated themselves and joined in earnest talk. At the door Allan had waited, for he would not depart until His Majesty had seated himself. A strange gladness was in the boy's heart, for had not his king fought for him? Here in this court he too would find adventure. Sir Percival mayhap some day would dub him knight, should he prove faithful and worthy. What greater glory could there be than to fight for such a king, and with such brave men? "But I must be off," he suddenly bethought himself, "else Sir Percival will not be pleased." And therewith he made great haste to depart. "Aye, sire," Merlin was now speaking, "my dream is indeed weighted with importance. But by the same token, it cannot be known until you call your court together, so that it may be heard by all." "Then mean you, kind Merlin, that we must call not only those of the Round Table, but all other knights and even pages and squires?" "Even so, sire. And yet, since Whitsunday is but a few days away, that should be no hard matter. For the knights of your court, except Sir Launcelot and Sir Gawaine, are here, prepared for such tourneys and feasts fit to celebrate that day." "So then shall it be. Even now our heralds shall announce that we crave the attendance of all those who pledge loyalty to our court. For I know well that they must be of no mean import, these things we shall hear. We pray only that they shall be for our good fortune." The wizard, making no reply, bent low and kissed his king's hand. Then he departed. Came now his herald, whom the king had summoned. "See to it that our court assembles this time tomorrow. Make far and distant outcry, so that all who are within ear may hear, and so hurry to our call. And mark you this well. We would hear Sir Launcelot and our own nephew, Sir Gawaine, present, even though they departed this early morn for Cornwall. See you to it." Swiftly the herald made for the door to carry out the commands of his king. But even as he reached it, Arthur called again to him. "We have a fancy, good herald, we fain would have you follow. Ask then Sir Percival to let us have the services of his page, who seems a likely youth, and bid this youth go hence after the two absent knights, Sir Gawaine and Sir Launcelot, and give to them our message, beseeching their return. Tell not the boy it is we who have asked that he go." "It shall be done as you will, sire," replied the herald. No surprise did he show at the strangeness of the king's command, for long had he been in his service, and well he knew the king's strange fancies. Sir Percival gave ready consent when found. So when the boy had returned from the errand forespoken, the herald announced that he must hasten after the two knights and bid them return. "And by my faith, lad, you have but little time, and you must speed well. For tomorrow at this time is this conclave called, and the two knights are already many miles on their journey. Take you this horse and hasten." Then, as the eager youth, quick-pulsed, made haste to obey, the herald added in kindly voice, "It would be well could you succeed, lad. For it is often true that through such missions, newcomers prove future worthiness for knighthood." "I thank you greatly for your kindness," replied the boy. "I can but try to the uttermost. No rest shall I have until I meet with the two knights." So now Allan sought out and bespoke his own lord. "I wish you well, Allan," said Sir Percival. "And say you to my friends Launcelot and Gawaine, should they prove reluctant, that they will favor their comrade Sir Percival, if they would make haste and hurry their return. Stop not to pick quarrel, nor to heed any call, urgent though it may seem. Prove my true page and worthy." "I shall do my very best, my lord. And this my first commission shall prove successful, even though to make it so I perish." Swiftly now rode forth the boyish figure. Well, too, had Arthur chosen. Came a day when then Allan, no braver, truer knight there was. But of that anon. Chapter 3. A Combat. "Good Launcelot, I trust that good fortune shall be with us, and that our adventures be many, and the knights we meet bold and brave. Of that, Gawaine, we need have no fear. For adventure ever follows where one seeks, and often enough overtakes the seeker. Let us rather hope that we shall find Sir Tristram and Sir Dinadian, both of Cornwall. For myself, I would joust with Sir Tristram, than whom braver and bolder knight does not live. And as for me," spoke Gawaine, "my anxiety is to see Mark, the King of Cornwall, and tell him to his face that I deem him a scurvy hound, since he promised protection to Beatrice of Banasar as she passed through his lands, and yet broke his promise and so holds her for ransom. And there shall I help you, dear Gawaine. For bitterly shall Mark rue his unknightly act. Shall I even wait for my event with Sir Tristram, until your business is done? Aye, and gladly will Sir Tristram wait, I wot, if he deems it honor to meet with Sir Launcelot du Lake. For no knight there is, who doth not know of your prowess and repute, Sir Tristram least of all. Kind words, Gawaine, for which I thank you. Yet if I mistake not, yonder, adventure seems to wait. And we but a little more than 20 miles from our gates. Ahead of them and barring their way were 10 knights. Launcelot and Gawaine stopped not a moment their pace, but rode boldly forward. "And wherefore do you, strange knights, dispute our passage?" asked Sir Gawaine. "Safely may you both pass, unless you be gentlemen of King Arthur's court," quoth the leader who stepped forward to answer. "And what if we be, Sir Knight?" replied Sir Launcelot mildly. "And if you be, then must you battle to the uttermost. For we owe loyalty to King Ryence, who is enemy of King Arthur. Therefore are we his enemies too, and enemies also of all of King Arthur's subjects. And thus we flaunt our enmity. We here and now call King Arthur an upstart, and if you be of his court, you cannot do aught else but fight with us." "Keep you your words," said Sir Gawaine, "until we have ceased our quarrel. Then if you will, you may call Arthur any names. Prepare you." Boldly Sir Launcelot and Sir Gawaine charged upon the foe. Nor did the knights who met them know who these two were, else milder were their tone. Such was the valor of the two, and such their strength, that 4 men were thrown from their horses in that first attack, and of these 2 were grievously wounded. Together and well they fought. Easily did they withstand the men of King Ryence. 4 men were slain by their might through wondrous and fearful strokes, and 4 were sorely wounded. There lay the 4 against an oaken tree, where they had been placed in a moment's lull. But 2 knights were left to oppose Launcelot and Gawaine, but these 2 were gallant men and worthy, the very best of all the 10. So they fought again, each with a single foe. Hard pressed were the 2 men of King Ryence, yet stubbornly they would not give way. and as each side gave blow for blow, so each called for Arthur or for Ryence, whichever the case might be. Many hours they fought, until at last Sir Launcelot by a powerful blow crashed both foe and foe's horse to the ground. And as the other would further combat, though exceedingly weak, Sir Launcelot, upraised lance in hand by a swift stroke, smote sword from out of his weakened grasp. "Thou art a brave knight, friend. And having fought so well, I ask no further penance but this, that you do now declare King Arthur no upstart. I care not for your enmity, but I will abide no slander. So must I then declare, since you have proven better man than I," declared the conquered knight. "And for your leniency I owe you thanks. Wherefore then to whom am I grateful? I pray your name?" "That I shall not tell until I hear your own," replied Launcelot. "I am known as Ronald de Lisle," the other replied in subdued tone. "Truly and well have I heard of you as a brave knight," was the reply, "and now I know it to be so. I am Sir Launcelot du Lake. Then indeed is honor mine and glory too. For honor it is to succumb to Sir Launcelot." But now both heard the voice of Gawaine. Weak had he grown, but weaker still his foe. Gawaine had brought the other to earth at last with swift and mighty blow, and such was the force of his stroke the fallen man could not rise, although he made great ado so to do. "So must I yield," this knight declared. "Now will I admit Arthur no upstart, but though I die for it, I do declare no greater king than Ryence ever lived. By my faith, your words are but such as any knight must hold of his own sovereign prince. I cannot take offense at brave words, Sir Knight. Now give me your name, for you are strong and worthy. I am Marvin, brother of him who fought with your comrade. And never have we met bolder and greater knights. I am Gawaine, and he who fought your brother is none other than Launcelot." "Then truly have we met no mean foes," replied the other. Conquered and conquerors now turned to make the wounded as comfortable as they well could be. After which, our two knights debated going on their journey or tarrying where they were until the morn. "Let us wend our way until we find fit place for food and rest. There can we tarry." So spoke Launcelot, and the other agreed. Then they took leave of Sir Marvin and Sir Ronald, and so on their way. Not many miles did they go, however, before they found suitable place. Late was the hour, and weary, and much in need of rest were the two knights. So they slept while half his journey covered. Allan sped onward, making fast time because he was but light of weight and his horse exceeding swift. Chapter 4. Allan meets the knights. From the first day when Allan began to understand the tales of chivalry and knightly deeds, he fancied and longed for the day when he would grow into manhood and by the same token into knighthood. Then would he go unto King Arthur on some Pentecost and crave the boon of serving him. Mayhap too, he would through brave and worthy deeds gain seat among those of the Round Table. So he would dream this youth with eager eyes, and his father, Sir Gaunt, soon came to know of his son's fancies and was overly proud and pleased with them. For he himself had in his days been a great and worthy knight, of many adventures and victor of many an onslaught. It pleased him that son of his would follow in his footsteps. When Allan was 14, Sir Gaunt proceeded to Sir Percival, who was great friend of his, and bespoke for his son the place of page. And so to please Sir Gaunt and for friendship's sake, Sir Percival gave ready consent. Therewith he found the youth pleasing to the eye, and of a great willingness to serve. So must we return to Allan, who is now on his way for many an hour. As he made his way, he marveled that he should have had notice brought upon himself, for he was young and diffident, and should by every token have escaped attention in these his first days at court. How would his heart have grown tumultuous, had he known that none other than Arthur himself had made him choice. But that he was not to know for many a year. Night came on and the boy travelled far. Yet gave he no thought to rest, for he knew that he could ill afford to tarry, and that only with the best of fortune could he overtake the two knights in time to make early return. About him, the woods were dark and mysterious. Owls hooted now and then, and other sounds of the night there were, yet was the boy so filled with urge of his mission that he found not time to think of ghosts nor black magic. Then, as he turned the road, he saw the dim shadow of a horse. Ghostly it seemed, until through closer view it proved flesh and blood. Lying close by was a knight who seemed exceeding weak and sorely wounded. Quick from his horse came Allan, and so made the strange knight be of greater comfort. Now the knight spoke weakly. "Grievously have I been dealt with by an outlaw band. This day was I to meet my two brothers, Sir Ronald and Sir Marvin, yet cannot proceed for very weakness. Which way do you go, lad?"
"I keep on my way to Cornwall," replied Allan.
"From yonder do my brothers journey, and should you meet with them, bid them hasten here so that together we can go forth to find this outlaw band and it chastise."
"That shall I do, Sir Knight. It grieves me that I may not stay, and give you such aid as I may, but so must I hasten that I cannot. Yet shall I stop at first abode, and commission them to hurry here to you.
For that I thank you, lad. And should time ever come when you my aid require, know then to call on Philip of Guile." So Allan pressed forward. At early dawn he came upon Sir Ronald and Sir Marvin, who had found rest along the wayside. And when he found that these were the two knights, he gave them their brother's message.
"Then must we hasten thence, Ronald.
And thank you, lad, for bringing us this message. Choose you and you can rest a while and partake of such food that we have."
"A food I will have, Sir Knights, for hunger calls most urgently. But tarry I cannot, for I must find Sir Launcelot and Sir Gawaine. Mayhap you have met with them."
"Of a truth can we say that we have met with them, and suffered thereby. Yet do we hold proof as to their knightly valor and skill. They have gone but a little way, for it was their purpose to find rest nearby. We doubt not you will find them at the first fair abode. In the meantime must we hasten to our brother's aid, and leave our wounded comrades to such care as they may get."
The knights spoke truly, for Allan found upon inquiry that the two he sought were lodged close by. Boldly the boy called, now for Sir Launcelot, now for Sir Gawaine, but both were overtired and of a great weariness, and it took many minutes before at last Sir Launcelot opened wide his eyes.
"And who are you, boy?" for he knew him not.
"My name is Allan, and I am page to Sir Percival."
"Come you with a message from Sir Percival? Does he need our help?"
"Nay, sir. Rather do I come with a message from the court, the herald of which sent me urging you and Sir Gawaine to return before sundown, for a great conclave is to gather which the king himself has called."
"Awaken then, thou sleepy knight," Sir Launcelot called to his comrade who had not stirred.
"It were pity that all this must be told to you again."
Sir Gawaine now arose, rubbing eyes still filled with sleep. To him Allan repeated his message.
"What say you, Gawaine? Shall we return?"
"As for me," replied Sir Gawaine, "I would say no. What matter if we are or are not present?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.